From the macabre minds of Laughing Devil Production comes another story from the Nightshade Diary. You know what that means. Check under the bed and make sure no one or nothing is there. Is the closet door securely shut? Then leave your disbelief behind, amp up your imagination, and hang on tight for another ride into terror and mystery. And like all good horror stories, just imagine it's a dark and stormy night. And remember, screaming like a little girl is permitted. The Prescription by Marjorie Bowen. John Cumming collected ghost stories. He always declared that this was the best that he knew, although it was partially second-hand and contained a mystery that had no reasonable solution, while most really good ghost stories allow a plausible explanation, even if it is one as feeble as a dream, excusing all, or an hallucination or a crude deception. Cumming told the story rather well. The first part of it, at least, had come under his own observation and been carefully noted by him in the flat green book which he kept for the record of all curious cases of this sort. He was a shrewd and trained observer. He honestly restrained his love of drama from leading him into embellishing facts. Cumming told the story to us all on the most suitable occasion, Christmas Eve, and prefaced it with a little homily. You all know the good old saw. The more it changes, the more it is the same thing. And I should like you to notice that this extremely up-to-date, ultra-modern ghost story is really almost exactly the same as one that might have puzzled Babylonian or Assyrian sages. I can give you the first start of the tale in my own words, but the second part will have to be in the words of someone else. They were, however, most carefully and scrupulously taken down. As for the conclusion, I must leave you to draw that for yourselves. Each according to your own mood, fancy, and temperament. It may be that you will all think of the same solution. It may be that you will each think of a different one. And it may be that every one of you will be left wondering. Having thus enjoyed himself by whetting our curiosity, Cumming settled himself down comfortably in his deep armchair and unfolded his tale. It was about 5 years ago. I don't wish to be exact with time, and of course I shall alter names. That's one of the first rules of the game, isn't it? Well, whenever it was, I was the guest of a Mrs. Janey, who, to some extent, was a friend of mine, an intelligent, lively, rather bustling sort of woman who had the knack of gathering interesting people around her. She had lately taken a new house in Buckinghamshire. It stood in the grounds of one of those large estates which are now so frequently being broken up. She was very pleased with the house, which was quite new and had only been finished a year and seemed, according to her own rather excited imagination, in every way desirable. I don't want to emphasize anything about the house except that it was new and did stand on the verge, as it were, of this large old estate, which had belonged to one of those notable English families now extinct and completely forgotten. I am no antiquarian or connoisseur in architecture, and the rather blatant modernity of the house did not offend me. I was able to appreciate its comfort and to enjoy what Mrs. Janey rather maddeningly called the old-world gardens, which were really a section of the larger gardens of the vanished mansion which had once commanded this domain. Mrs. Janey, I should tell you, knew nothing about the neighborhood, nor anyone who lived there, except that for the first it was very convenient for town, and for the second she believed that they were all nice people, not likely to bother one. I was slightly disappointed with the crowd she had gathered together at Christmas. They were all people whom either I knew too well or whom I didn't wish to know at all, and at first the party showed signs of being extremely flat. Mrs. Janey seemed to perceive this too, and with rather nervous haste produced, on Christmas Eve, a trump card in the way of amusement. A professional medium called Mrs. Mahogany, because that could not possibly have been her name. Some of us believed in, as the saying goes, mediums, and some didn't. But we were all willing to be diverted by the experiment. Mrs. Janey continually lamented that a certain Dr. Dilk would not be present. He was going to be one of the party, but had been detained in town, and would not reach Verall, which was the name of the house, until later, and the medium, it seemed, could not stay, for she, being a personage in great demand, must go on to a further engagement. I, of course, like everyone else possessed of an intelligent curiosity and a certain amount of leisure, had been to mediums before. I had been slightly impressed, slightly disgusted, and very much bewildered, and on the whole had decided to let the matter alone, considering what I really preferred, the more direct and old-fashioned method of getting in touch with what we used to call the unseen. This sitting in the great new house seemed rather banal. I could understand, in some haunted old manner, that a clairvoyant or a clairaudient or a trance medium might have found something interesting to say, but what was she going to get out of Mrs. Janey's bright, brilliant, and comfortable dwelling? Mrs. Mahogany was a nondescript sort of woman, neither young nor old, neither clever nor stupid, neither dark nor fair, placid, and not in the least self-conscious. After an extremely good luncheon, it was a gloomy, stormy afternoon, we all sat down in a circle in the cheerful drawing room. The curtains were pulled across the dreary prospect of gray sky and gray landscape, and we had merely the light of the fire. We sat quite close together in order to increase the power, as Mrs. Mahogany said, and the medium sat in the middle, with no special precautions against trickery. But we all knew that trickery would have been really impossible, and we were quite prepared to be tremendously impressed and startled if any manifestation took place. I think we were all rather foolish, as we did not know each other very well, sitting round there staring at this very ordinary, rather common, stout little woman, who kept nervously pulling a little tippet of grey wool over her shoulder, closing her eyes and muttering while she twisted her fingers together. When we had sat silent for about 10 minutes, Mrs. Janey announced in a rather raw whisper that the medium had gone into trance. "Beautifully," she added. I thought that Mrs. Mahogany did not look at all beautiful. Her communication began with a lot of rambling talk which had no point at all, and a good deal of generalization, under which I think we all became a little restive. There was too much of various spirits who had all sorts of ordinary names, just regular Tom, Dicks, and Harrys of the spirit world, floating round behind us, their arms full of flowers and their mouths full of goodwill, all rather pointless. And though occasionally a Tom, Dick, or a Harry was identified by some of us, it wasn't very convincing, and what was worse, not very interesting. We got, however, our surprise and our shock, because Mrs. Mahogany began suddenly to writhe into ugly contortions and called out in a loud voice, quite different from the one that she had hitherto used. "Murder!" This word gave us all a little thrill, and we leant forward eagerly to hear what further she had to say. With every sign of distress and horror, Mrs. Mahogany began to speak. "He's murdered her. Oh, how dreadful. Look at him. Can't somebody stop him? It's so near here, too. He tried to save her. He was sorry, you know. Oh, how dreadful. Look at him. He's borne it as long as he can, and now he's murdered her. I see him mixing it in a glass. Oh, isn't it awful that no one could have saved her, and he was so terribly remorseful afterwards. Oh, how dreadful, how horrible!" She ended in a whimpering of frightened horror, and Mrs. Janey, who seemed an adept at this sort of thing, leaned forward and asked eagerly, "Can't you get the name? Can't you find out who it is? Why do you get that here?" "I don't know," muttered the medium. "It's somewhere near here, a house, an old dark house, and there are curtains of mauve velvet. Do you call it mauve? A kind of blue-red. At the windows, there's a garden outside with a fish pond, and you go through a low doorway and down stone steps." "It isn't near here," said Mrs. Janey decidedly. "All the houses are new." "The house is near here," persisted the medium. "I am walking through it now. I can see the room. I can see that poor, poor woman, and a glass of milk." "I wish you'd get the name," insisted Mrs. Janey, as she cast a look as though not without suspicion round the circle. "You can't be getting this from my house, you know, Mrs. Mahogany," she added decidedly. "It must be given out by someone here. Something they've read or seen, you know," she said to reassure us that our characters were not in dispute. But the medium replied doubtfully, "No, it's somewhere near here. I see a light dress covered with small roses. If he could have got help, he would have gone for it. But there was no one, so all his remorse was useless." No further urging would induce the medium to say more. Soon afterwards, he came out of the trance, and all of us, I think, felt that she had made rather a stupid blunder by introducing this vague piece of melodrama, and if it was, as we suspected, a cheap attempt to give us a ghostly and mysterious atmosphere to Christmas Eve, it was a failure. When Mrs. Mahogany, blinking round her, said brightly, "Well, here I am again. I wonder if I said anything that interested you," we all replied rather coldly, "Of course, it has been most interesting, but there hasn't been anything definite." And I think that even Mrs. Janey felt that the sitting had been rather a disappointment, and she suggested that if the weather was really too horrible to venture out of doors, we should sit round the fire and tell old-fashioned ghost stories. "The kind," she said brightly, "that are about bones and chains and shrouds. I really think that is the most thrilling kind after all." Then, with some embarrassment, and when Mrs. Mahogany had left the room, she suggested that not one of us should say anything about the medium and what she had said in her trance. "It's really rather absurd," said our hostess, "and it would make me look a little foolish if it got about. You know, some people think these mediums are absolute fakes, and anyhow, the whole thing, I'm afraid, was quite stupid. She must have got her contacts mixed. There is no old house about here, and never has been since the original Rural was pulled down, and that's a good 50 years ago, I believe, from what the estate agent told me. And as for a murder, I never heard the shadow of any such story." We all agreed not to mention what the medium had said, and did this with the more heartiness as we were not any one of us impressed. The feeling was rather that Mrs. Mahogany had been obliged to say something, and had said that. "Well," said Cumming comfortably, "that is the first part of my story, and I dare say you'll think it's dull enough. Now we come to the second part." Latish that evening, Dr. Dilke arrived. He was not in any way a remarkable man, just an ordinary, successful physician, and I refuse to say that he was suffering from overwork or nervous strain. You know that is so often put into this kind of story as an excuse for what happened afterwards. On the contrary, Dr. Dilke seemed to be in the most robust of health and the most cheerful frame of mind, and quite prepared to make the most of his brief holiday. The car that fetched him from the station was taking Mrs. Mahogany away, and the doctor and the medium met for just a moment in the hall. Mrs. Janey did not trouble to introduce them, but without waiting for this, Mrs. Mahogany turned to the doctor, and looking at him fixedly said, "You're very psychic, aren't you?" And upon that, Mrs. Janey was forced to say hastily, "This is Mrs. Mahogany, Dr. Dilke, the famous medium." The physician was indifferently impressed. "I really don't know," he answered, smiling. "I've never got in for that sort of thing. I shouldn't think I am what you call psychic, really. I've had a hard scientific training, and that rather knocks the bottom out of fantasies." "Well, you are, you know," said Mrs. Mahogany. "I felt it at once. I shouldn't be at all surprised if you had some strange experience one of these days." Mrs. Mahogany left the house and was duly driven away to the station. I want to make the point very clear that she and Dr. Dilke did not meet again, and that they held no communication except those few words in the hall, spoken in the presence of Mrs. Janey. Of course, Dr. Dilke got twitted a good deal about what the medium had said. It made quite a topic of conversation during dinner and after dinner, and we all had queer little ghost stories or incidents of what we considered psychic experiences to trot out and discuss. Dr. Dilke remained civil, amused, but entirely unconvinced. He had what he called a material or physical or medical explanation for almost everything that we said, and apart from all these explanations, he added, with some justice, that human credulity was such that there was always someone who would accept and embellish anything, however wild, unlikely, or grotesque it was. "I should rather like to hear what you would say if such an experience happened to you," Mrs. Janey challenged him. "Whether you used the ancient terms of ghost, witches, black magic, and so on, or whether you speak in modern terms like medium, clairvoyance, psychic contacts, and all the rest of it. Well, it seems one is in a bit of a tangle anyhow, and if any queer thing ever happens to you..." Dr. Dilke broke in pleasantly, "Well, if it ever does, I will let you all know about it, and I dare say I shall have an explanation to add at the end of the tale." When we all met again the next morning, we rather hoped that Dr. Dilke would have something to tell us, some odd experience that might have befallen him in the night, new as the house was, and banal as was his bedroom. He told us, of course, that he had passed a perfectly good night. We most of us went into the morning service in the small church that had once been the chapel belonging to the demolished mansion, and which had some rather curious monuments inside and in the churchyard. As I went in, I noticed a mortuary chapel, with niches for the coffins to be stood upright, now whitewashed and used as a sacristy. The monuments and mural tablets were mostly to the memory of members of the family of Verall. The Verals of Verall Hall, who appeared to have been people of little interest or distinction. Dr. Dilk sat beside me, and I, having nothing better to do, through the more familiar, monotonous portions of the service, found myself idly looking at the mural table beyond him. This was a large slab of black marble, deeply cut, with a very worn Latin inscription, which I found unconsciously I was spelling out. The stone, it seemed, commemorated a woman who had been, of course, the possessor of all the virtues. Her name was Philadelphia Carwithin, and I rather pleasantly sampled the flavor of that ancient name. Philadelphia. Then I noticed a smaller inscription at the bottom of the slab, which indicated that the lady's husband also rested in the vault. He had died suddenly about 6 months after her, of grief at her loss, no doubt, I thought, scenting out a pretty romance. As we walked home across the frost-bitten fields and icy lanes, Dr. Dilk, who walked beside me, as he had sat beside me in church, began to complain of cold. He said he believed that he had caught a chill. I was rather amused to hear this old womanish expression on the lips of so distinguished a physician, and I told him that I had been taught in my more enlightened days that there was no such thing as catching a chill. To my surprise, he did not laugh at this, but said, "Well, yes, there is, and I believe I've got it. I keep on shivering. I think it was that slab of black stone I was sitting next to. It was as cold as ice where I touched it, and it seemed to be exuding moisture. Some of that old stone does, you know. It's always, as it were, sweating. And I felt exactly as if I were sitting next to a slab of ice from which a cold wind was blowing. It was really as if it penetrated my flesh." He looked pale, and I thought how disagreeable it would be for us all, and particularly for Mrs. Janey, if the good man was to be taken ill in the midst of her already not successful Christmas party. Dr. Dilk seemed, too, in that ill humor which so often presages an illness. He was quite peevish about the church and the service, and the fact that he had been asked to go there. "These places are nothing but charnel houses, after all," he said, fretfully. "One sits there amongst all those rotting bones with that damp marble at one side." "It is supposed to give you atmosphere," I said. "The atmosphere of an old-fashioned Christmas. Did you notice who your black stone was erected to the memory of?" I asked, and the doctor replied that he had not. "It was to a young woman. A young woman, I took it, and her husband, Philadelphia Carwithin. I noticed that, and of course there was a long eulogy of her virtues, and then underneath it just said that he had died a few months afterwards. As far as I could see, it was the only example of that name in the church. All the rest were Verals. I suppose there were strangers here." "What was the date?" asked the doctor, and I replied that really I had not been able to make it out, for where the woman figures came, the stones had been very warm. The day ambled along somehow, with games, diversions, and plenty of good food and drink, and towards the evening we began to feel a little more satisfied with each other and our hostess. Only Dr. Dilk remained a little peevish and apart, and this was remarkable in one who was obviously of a robust temperament and an even temper. He still continued to talk of a chill, and I did notice that he shuddered once or twice, and continually sat near the large fire, which Mrs. Janey had rather laboriously arranged in imitation of what she would call the good old times. That evening, the evening of Christmas Day, there was no talk whatever of ghosts or psychic matters. Our discussions were entirely topical and of mundane matters, in which Dr. Dilk, who seemed to have recovered his spirits, took his part with ability and agreeableness. When it was time to break up, I asked him, half in jest, about his mysterious chill, and he looked at me with some surprise, and appeared to have forgotten that he had ever said he had got such a thing. The impression, whatever it was, which he had received in the church had evidently been effaced from his mind. I wish to make that quite clear. The next morning Dr. Dilk appeared very late at the breakfast table, and when he did so his looks were matter for hints and comments. He was pale, distracted, troubled, untied in his dress, absent in his manner, and I at least instantly recall what he had said yesterday and feared he was sickening for some illness. On Mrs. Janey putting to him some direct question as to his looks and manner, so strange and so troubled, he replied rather sharply, "Well, I don't know what you can expect from a fellow who's been up all night. I thought I came down here for a rest." We all looked at him as he dropped into his place and began to drink his coffee with eager gusto. I noticed that he continually shivered. There was something about this astounding statement and his curious appearance which held us all discreetly silent. We waited for further developments before committing ourselves. Even Mrs. Janey, whom I had never thought of as tactful, contrived to say casually, "Up all night, doctor? Couldn't you sleep, then? I'm so sorry if your bed wasn't comfortable." "The bed was all right," he answered. "That made me the more sorry to leave it. Haven't you got a local doctor who can take the local cases?" he added. "Why, of course we have. There's Dr. Armstrong and Dr. Fraser. I'm sure about that before I came here." "Well, then," demanded Dr. Dilk angrily, "why on earth couldn't one of them have gone last night?" Mrs. Janey looked at me helplessly, and I, obeying her glance, took up the matter. "What do you mean, doctor? Do you mean that you were called out of your bed last night to attend a case?" I asked deliberately. "Of course I was. I only got back with the dawn." Here Mrs. Janey could not forbear breaking in. "But whoever could it have been? I know nobody about here yet, at least only one or two people by name, and they would not be aware that you were here. And how did you get out of the house? It's locked every night." Then the doctor gave his story, and rather, I must confess, a confused fashion, and yet with an earnest conviction that he was speaking the simple truth. It was broken up a good deal by ejaculations and comments from the rest of us, but I give it to you here shorn of all that, and exactly as I put it down in my notebook afterwards. I was awoken by a tap at the door. I was instantly wide awake, and I said, "Come in." I thought immediately that probably someone in the house was ill. A doctor, you know, is always ready for these emergencies. The door opened at once, and a man entered holding a small ordinary storm lantern. I noticed nothing peculiar about the man. He had a dark great coat on and appeared extremely anxious. "I'm sorry to disturb you," he said at once, "but there is a young woman dangerously ill. I want you to come and see her." I somehow did not think of arguing or suggesting that there were other medical men in the neighborhood, or of asking how it was he knew of my presence at Verral. I dressed myself quickly and accompanied him out of the house. He opened the front door without any trouble, and it did not occur to me to ask how he had been obtained either admission or egress. There was a small carriage outside the door, such a one as you may still see in isolated country places, but such a one as I certainly was surprised to see here. I could not very well make out either the horse or the driver, for though the moon was high in the heavens, it was frequently obscured by clouds. I got into the carriage and noticed, as I have often noticed before in these ancient vehicles, the most repulsive smell of decay and damp. My companion got in beside me. He did not speak a word during the whole of the journey, which was, I have the impression, extremely long. I had also the sense that he was in the greatest trouble, anguish, and almost despair. I do not know why I did not question him. I should tell you that he has drawn down the blinds of the carriage and we traveled in darkness, yet I was perfectly aware of his presence, and seemed to see him in his heavy, dark greatcoat turned up around his chin, his black hair low on his forehead, and his anxious, furtive dark eyes. I think I may have gone to sleep in the carriage. I was tired and cold. I was aware, however, when it stopped, and of my companion opening the door and helping me out. We went through a garden, down some steps, and past a fish pond. I could see by the moonlight the silver and gold shapes of the fishes slipping in and out of the black water. We entered the house by a side door. I remember that very distinctly, and went up what seemed to be some sort of secret or seldom used stairs and into a bedroom. I was by now quite alert, as is one when one gets into the presence of the patient. I said to myself, "What a fool I've been. I brought nothing with me," and I tried to remember, but could not quite do so, whether or not I brought anything with me, my cases and so on, to Verral. The room was very badly lit, but a certain illumination, I could not say whether it came from any artificial light within the room, or merely from the moonlight through the open window, draped with mauve velvet curtains, fell on the bed, and there I saw my patient. She was a young woman, who I surmised would have been, when in health, of considerable though coarse charm. She was now in great suffering, twisted and contorted with agony, and in her struggles of anguish had pulled and torn the bedclothes into a heap. I noticed that she wore a dress of some light material spotted with small roses. It had occurred to me at once that she had been taken ill during the daytime, and must have lain thus in great pain for many hours, and I turned with some reproach to the man who had fetched me, and demanded why help had not been brought sooner. For answer, he wrung his hands, a gesture that I do not remember having noticed in any human being before. One hears a great deal of hands being wrung, but one does not so often see it. This man, I remember distinctly, wrung his hands and muttered, "Do what you can for her. Do what you can." I feared that this would be very little. I endeavored to make an examination of the patient, but owing to her half-delirious struggles, this was very difficult. She was, however, I thought, likely to die, and of what malady I could not determine. There was a table nearby on which lay some papers. One I took to be a will, and a glass in which there had been milk. I do not remember seeing anything else in the room. The light was so bad. I endeavored to question the man, whom I took to be the husband, but without any success. He merely repeated his monotonous appeal for me to save her. Then I was aware of a sound outside the room, of a woman laughing, perpetually and shrilly laughing. "Pray stop that," I cried to the man. "Who have you got in the house, a lunatic?" But he took no notice of my appeal, merely repeating his own hushed lamentations. The sick woman appeared to hear that demoniacal laugh outside, and raising herself on one elbow said, "You have destroyed me, and you may well laugh." I sat down at the table on which were the papers and the glass, half full of milk, and wrote a prescription on a sheet torn out of my notebook. The man snatched it eagerly. "I don't know when and where you can get that made up," I said, "but it's the only hope." At this he seemed wishful for me to depart, as wishful as he had been for me to come. "That's all I want," he said. He took me by the arm and led me out of the house by the same back stairs. As I descended, I still heard those two dreadful sounds, the thin laughter of the woman I had not seen, and the groans, becoming every moment fainter, one of the young women whom I had seen. The carriage was waiting for me, and I was driven back by the same way I had come. When I reached the house and my room, I saw the dawn just breaking. I rested till I heard the breakfast gong. I suppose some time had gone by since I returned to the house, but I wasn't quite aware of it. All through the night, I had rather lost a sense of time. When Dr. Dilke had finished his narrative, which I gave here baldly, but I hope to the point, we all glanced at each other rather uncomfortably, for who was to tell a man like Dr. Dilke that he had been suffering from a severe hallucination? It was, of course, quite impossible that he could have left the house and gone through the peculiar scenes he had just described, and esteem extraordinary that he could for a moment have believed that he had done so. What was even more remarkable was that so many points of his story agreed with what the medium, Mrs. Mahogany, had said in trance. We recognized the frock with the roses, the mauve velvet curtains, the glass of milk. The man who had fetched Dr. Dilke sounded like the murderer, and the unfortunate woman writhing on the bed sounded like the victim. But how had the doctor got hold of those particulars? We all knew that he had not spoken to Mrs. Mahogany, and he suspected the other of having told him what the medium had said, and that this, having wrought on his mind, he had the dream, vision, or hallucination he had just described to us. I must add that this was found afterwards to be wholly false. We were all reliable people, and there was not a shadow of doubt. We had all kept our counsel about Mrs. Mahogany. In fact, none of us had been alone with Dr. Dilke the previous day for more than a moment or so, save myself, who had walked with him from the church, wherein we had certainly spoken of nothing except the black stone in the church and the chill which he had said emanated from it. Well, to put the matter as briefly as possible and to leave out a great deal of amazement and wonder, explanation and so on, we will come to the point when Dr. Dilke was finally persuaded that he had not left for all the night. When his story was taken to pieces and put before him, as it were, in the raw, he himself recognized many absurdities. How could the man have come straight to his bedroom? How could he have left the house? The doors were locked every night. There was no doubt about that. Where did the carriage come from? And where was the house to which he had been taken? And who could possibly have known of his presence in the neighborhood? Had not, too, the scene in the house to which he was taken all the resemblance of a nightmare? Who was it laughing in the other room? What was the mysterious illness that was destroying the young woman? Who was the black-browed man who had fetched him? And in these days of telephone and motor cars, people didn't go out in the old-fashioned one-horse carriages to fetch doctors from miles away in the case of dangerous illness. Dr. Dilk was finally silenced, uneasy, but not convinced. I could see that he disliked intensely the idea that he had been the victim of a hallucination, that he equally intensely regretted the impulse which had made him relate his extraordinary adventure of the night. I could only conclude that he must have done so while still, to an extent, under the influence of his delusion, which had been so strong that never for a moment had he questioned the reality of it. Though he was forced at last to allow us to put the whole thing down as a most remarkable dream, I could see that he did not intend to let the matter rest there. And late in the day, out of good manners, we had eventually ceased discussing the story. He asked me if I would accompany him on some investigation in the neighborhood. "I think I should know the house," he said, "even though I saw it in the dark." I was impressed by the fish pond and the low doorway through which I had to stoop in order to pass without knocking my head. I did not tell him that Mrs. Mahogany had also mentioned a fish pond and a low door. We made the excuse of some old brasses we wished to discover in a nearby church to take my car and go out that afternoon on an investigation of the neighborhood in the hope of discovering Dr. Dilk's dream house. We covered a good deal of distance and spent a good deal of time without any success at all, and the day was already darkening when we came upon a row of almshouses in which, for no reason at all that I could discern, Dr. Dilk showed an interest and insisted on stopping before them. He pointed out an inscription cut in the center gable, which said there had been built by a certain Richard Carwithin in memory of Philadelphia, his wife. "The people whose tablet you sat next in the church," I remarked. "Yes," murmured Dr. Dilk. "When I felt the chill," and he added, "when I first felt the chill, you see the date is 1830. That would be about right." We stopped in the little village, which was a good many miles from Vorel, and after some tedious delays, because everything was shut up for the holiday, we did discover an old man who was willing to tell us something about the almshouses, though there was nothing much to be said about them. They had been founded by a certain Mr. Richard Carwithin, with his wife's fortune. He had been a poor man, a kind of adventurer, our informant thought, who had married a wealthy woman. They had not been happy at all. There had been quarrels and disputes and a separation, at least, so the gossip went, as his father had told it to him. Finally, the Carwithins had taken a house here in the village of Sunsford. A large house it was, and it still stood. The Carwithins weren't buried in this village, though, but at Vorel. She had been a Vorel by birth. Perhaps that's why they came to this neighborhood. It was the name of a great family in those days, you know. There was another woman in the old story as it went, and she got hold of Mr. Carwithin and was for making him put his wife aside, and so, perhaps, he would have done, but the poor lady died suddenly, and there was some talk about it, having the other woman in the house at the time, and it being so convenient for both of them. But he didn't marry the other woman, because he died 6 months after his wife. By his will, he left all his wife's money to found those almshouses. Dr. Dilk asked if he could see the house where the Carwithins had lived. "It belongs to a London gentleman," the old man said, "who never comes here. It's going to be pulled down and the land sold in building lots. Why, it's been locked up these 10 years or more. I don't suppose it's been inhabited since. No, not for 100 years. Well, I'm looking for a house round about here. I don't mind spending a little money on repairs if that house is in the market." The old man didn't know whether it was in the market or not, but he kept repeating that the property was to be sold and broken up for building lots. "I won't bother you with all our delays and arguments, but merely tell you that we did finally discover the lodgekeeper of the estate, who gave us the key. It was not such a very large estate, nothing to be compared to Vorel, but had been, in its time, of some pretension. Builders' boards had already been raised along the high road frontage. There were some old fine trees, black and bare, in a little park. As we turned in through the rusty gates and motored towards the house, it was nearly dark, but we had our electric torches and the powerful headlamps of the car. Dr. Dilk made no comment on what we had found, but he reconstructed the story of the Carwithins, whose names were on that black stone in Morale Church. They were quarreling over money. He was trying to get her to sign a will in his favor. She had some little sickness, perhaps, brought on probably by rage. He had got the other woman in the house, remember? I expect he was no good. There was some sort of poison about, perhaps for a face wash, perhaps as a drug. He put it in the milk and gave it to her. Here I interrupted. How do you know it was in the milk? The doctor did not reply to this. I had now swung the car around to the front of the ancient mansion, a poor pretentious place sinister in the half-darkness. And then, when he had done it, continued Dr. Joke, mounting the steps of the house, he repented most horribly. He wanted to fly for a doctor to get some antidote for the poison, with the idea in his head that if he could have got help, he could have saved her himself. The other woman kept on laughing. He couldn't forgive her that she could laugh at a moment like that. He couldn't get help. He couldn't find a doctor. His wife died. No one suspected foul play. They seldom did in those days, as long as the people were respectable. You must remember the state in which medical knowledge was in 1830. He couldn't marry the other woman, and he couldn't touch the money. He left it all to found the almshouses. Then he died himself, 6 months afterwards, leaving instructions that his name should be added to that black stone. I dare say he died by his own hand. Probably he loved her through it all, you know. It was only the money that cursed money, a fortune just within his grasp, but which he couldn't take. A pretty romance, I suggested, as we entered the house. I'm sure there's a 3-volume novel in it of what Mrs. Janey would call the good old-fashioned sort. To this Dr. Doak answered, suppose the miserable man can't rest, supposing he's still searching for a doctor. We passed from one room to another of the dismal, dusty, dismantled house. Dr. Doak opened the damaged shutter with concealed one of the windows at the back and pointed out in the waning light a decayed garden with stone steps and a fish pond, and a low gateway to pass through which a man of his height would have had to stoop. We could just discern this in the twilight. He made no comment. We went upstairs. Here, coming, paused dramatically to give us the full flavor of the final part of his story. He reminded us rather necessarily, for somehow he had convinced us that this was all perfectly true. I am not romancing. I won't answer for what Dr. Doak said or did, or the adventure of the night before, or the story of the Carwithens as he constructed it. But this is actually what happened. We went upstairs by the wide main stairs. Dr. Doak searched about for and found a door which opened onto the back stairs, and then he said, this must be the room. It was entirely devoid of any furniture, and stained with damp, the walls stripped of paneling and cheaply covered with decayed paper, peeling, and in parts fallen. What's this? Said Dr. Doak. He picked up a scrap of paper that showed vivid on the dusty floor and handed it to me. It was a prescription. He took out his notebook and showed me the page where this fitted in. This page I tore out last night when I wrote that prescription in this room. The bed was just there, and there was on the table where the papers and the glass of milk rested. But you couldn't have been here last night, I protested feebly. The locked doors, the whole thing. Dr. Doak said nothing. After a while, neither did I. Let's get out of this place, I said. Then another thought struck me. What is your prescription? I asked. He said, a very uncommon kind of prescription, a very desperate sort of prescription, one that I've never written before, nor I hope shall again. An antidote for severe arsenical poisoning. I leave you, smiled Cumming, to your various attitudes, or incredulity, or explanation.